Hello there. Welcome back to the booth here at the World Championships at PAX in Seattle. Marshall Sutcliffe, Jackie Lee, and Luis Scott Vargas. We're ready, right?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. He's real ready. We're ready for round six action here from the World Championship. Let's head down to the feature match area. Hello and welcome to coverage of the World Championship. We are here in Seattle, Washington at PAX. Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Luis Scott Vargas and Jackie Lee. And we're ready for round six action. Let's meet our players.
Thiago Saporito, Brazil, top pro points, Latin America.
Sam Black, United States of America, top pro points, North America.
All business from those two guys, and they're ready to fight down here at 3-2. You can see Thiago Saporito is playing Obzon here, Luis. He's transitioned it over. You know, we've seen this sort of grindy, Jundish variant in Modern for a while now, and it looks like Obzon's what he's decided to take. We're going to have you keep an eye on that for us. Sam Black, on the other hand, he's on Affinity. Highly aggressive, synergistic, artifact-based deck that we see here. And it looks like they're just underway. Luis, matchup-wise, what do you make of it?
This matchup tends to favor Affinity, especially if the Obzon deck doesn't have a lot of good sideboard cards against it. And looking at Thiago's sideboard, he's kind of got an uphill battle, especially since he did mold a five this game.
Yeah, he's down to five cards already. Jackie, obviously bad news for Thiago. Is this the kind of thing that he can recover from with an Obzon deck?
It's pretty difficult to say. If Sam has a fast start, then it may be very difficult, especially if Sam has access to Ink Moth Nexus, which is something that Obzon typically doesn't have a way to come back from, because Siege Rhino doesn't exactly remove poison counters.
And that's kind of the big finish for the Obzon deck, is a Siege Rhino.
Yes, it tends to help the Obzon deck pull back ahead from behind, and then also it's this huge presence on the board, so it helps you kind of edge ahead in the mid-game.
All right, so let's say that you're in Sam Black's seat here, Jackie. Not a bad turn one. He played a couple of Ornithopters, a Springleaf Drum, and an Ink Moth Nexus, a card you just mentioned a minute ago here. How's Sam feeling at this point?
Well, he does have a cranial plating in his hand, so that is going to potentially be a lot of damage. It could even be a lot of poison damage, which I think is perhaps one of his best options.
Here we have just Sam on a classic great affinity draw on the play against an opponent who mulled to five. So
he could just try to shut the door as quick as possible here, right?
Yeah, and it looks like he's actually chosen to develop his board. Rather than play the plating and hit for a couple damage, he would have gotten four in. He just chose to Thought Cast and play Steel Overseer, which is good. He's not really in a race. Thiago, there's not much Thiago can really get ahead with. Lingering Souls is one of Thiago's best cards. So if I'm Thiago, I'm really hoping to draw Lingering Souls early and often.
Yeah, that is a card that does serious work here. Although it's going to be Path to Exile to take down the Steel Overseer of Sam Black. Send that thing packing, and you'll note that Sam didn't even bother to pick up his library there.
Yeah, Affinity does frequently play one land for just this scenario, except this scenario doesn't usually involve drawing the actual islands. So.
Which, unfortunately for Sam Black, he had done and played, so no extra value. And Saporito says, it's not too bad at least. But Sam Black favoring, once again, just developing his board out. He's going to play an Etch Champion and just pass a turn back. And even though this has been a really strong draw for Sam, he hasn't actually done any damage yet.
Yeah, but Etch Champion is a huge problem for Obzon-type decks because it's not the fastest card, but it does get the job done eventually.
Look at this, a turn too late, Luis.
Well, it still can hit a Cranial Plating. Inquisition knocking Cranial Plating out of Sam's hand makes it a lot harder for him to end the game very quickly with Etch Champion. But, I mean, this attack with a Tarmogoyf, if you could just block with that champion.
And it looks like he figured it out.
It was a relatively free attack, though.
Yeah, that plating was likely one of his big sources of damage, so without it, Sam will have to see what he draws.
Now, see, Saporito's out of cards here. You see him play that Godless Shrine in pass, but he also has a Scavenging Ooze there on the battlefield now, too. So all thing, you know, all told, Thiago's actually had a pretty reasonable draw. Now, unfortunately for him, he is out of gas, thanks to the mulligan to five, so he's going to have to kind of rely on this board state in the top of his deck to get him through. In the meantime, Sam Black.
Two infect.
Yeah. Sam is rallying here. It's funny, because even though Sam had a great start on the play, Path plus Inquisition did actually put Thiago in an okay spot. So Sam just gets to start attacking with his Nexus, and he's, you know, those 2 points of poison are a faster clock, especially since Edge Champion is just sitting there on defense, stopping Tarmogoyf and Scavenging Ooze from doing that much damage.
Yeah, so that's two poison already on Thiago. And a little smirk from Sam, but he now has a game plan ahead of him. And we're going to see if it's going to work out for him here as he's going to go for the poison plan. Of course, also for Sam Black, you know, cranial platings off the top.
what did you say?
Well, sometimes the predictions just roll right in. Cranial plating off the top for Sam Black is what I meant to say. And
I've found things happen more frequently when I say them. So
is that right?
All I'm saying is I was hoping that you would draw the second island just for that thread.
Yeah, I was down in the feature match area, and I had the commentary in my head for that. It was pretty great. All right, so how much is this for Sam? Is it lethal?
It puts Thiago to 9, except Sam can then activate a Nexus, and that'll do the full 10, just the straight 2
wow.
shot.
Wow. He's passing priority here. Does Thiago, he counts it up. Does he have a removal spell? He has one unknown card in his hand. Cool. And they're just double-checking the math.
Yep.
Sam gives them a look like it's enough, and it was enough. So that's going to do it for game one. Sam Black, even though it took him a little time to kind of set up his board state and figure out how he wanted to win, the top deck there really helped him, and he picks up game one. We'll be back right after these messages.
Friday Night Magic has expanded to include all formats. Be ready for Standard, Commander, Legacy, or even Conspiracy Drafts. Check out your local store for details and share your FNM stories by using the hashtag MTGFNM. Visit magic.wizards.com/FNM for more information. Play in the Magic Online Championship Series. You can win a slot to compete against Sam Black, Magnus Lanto, and Mike Sigrist at the next Magic Online Championship. For more information, visit mtgo.com.
And welcome back to the feature match area here at the World Championship. Well, they're all shuffling. You know, we have 4 feature matches down there so that just in case, we'll usually have one to go to, but occasionally it ends like this where the games end up ending at the same time and we get the shuffle cam here. But I did want to take a minute to talk to you guys about your early thoughts on the decks that you've seen. You know, we've got the deck list in front of us and for the feature match and then for the rest of them that you guys have seen. Luis, any big surprises for you at a Modern?
I was surprised that the field had so many decks that there were a lot of copies of them, like 6 Affinity decks and a bunch of Boggle decks. It's just a little bit more multiples of decks than I'd expected. Modern's a pretty wide format, mm-hmm. So even though there aren't too many decks that are a big surprise, like Black-White Tokens and Blue-White Control are probably the 2 most, I guess, unexpected decks. There are a lot of duplicates here, so we're seeing, like, you know, in round 1, for example, we were like, all right, here's Boggles versus Affinity. Let's look in on Boggles versus Living End. Let's look in on Affinity versus Splinter Twin. So
yeah, there were actually 3 copies of that Boggles deck in the feature match area for that first round. I was down there, you know, keeping an eye on the tables, and I went, well, there's one. Wow, wait a minute, what's going on here? It looks like a popular choice.
Which is unfortunate for the people playing Boggles, given that Living End with 4 copies is the second most popular deck here. Yeah. And Living End, you'd rather be on the Living End side.
For sure, I saw that kind of take care of business down there. Jackie, what about you? Anything jump out to you?
Yeah, I was surprised that there were so many people playing Boggles. I know that the night before the tournament, some of the players were a little bit hesitant about it. I didn't expect so many to just kind of jump on. Again, that is a kind of deck where your matchups and the sideboard plans of all of your opponents is going to just be such a huge impact that comparatively you as a great player have less leverage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, we've seen this be successful before. In fact, it was actually that exact deck. Remember, Reed Duke got 2nd place with Boggles. And that was a strong metagame call that he made. It kind of came out of nowhere. I think he was the only one playing it. And, you know, he found himself in the finals against Shahar Shenhar in 2013 with that deck. So, you know, those gambles can pay off, right? You can take that hard line against the metagame and just hope that it all pans out. But like Luis said, sometimes half the field ends up being living end or whatever, and it's a matchup you perhaps aren't so excited to play against.
Certainly. But overall, I think that this is a pretty typical modern spread. There's just such a diversity of deck archetypes and also the specific colors, even in those. We saw a control mirror earlier that had, you know, a blue-red control deck facing a blue-white one, and they played very differently. Mm-hmm. So I really love to see those slight diversities.
Modern has always been kind of split between the interactive and non-interactive decks, and there's a lot more interactive decks here today. Living End, you know, and the green-white deck are on the further on the spectrum towards uninteractive, but Affinity is still an interactive deck. When you match Affinity against, like, one of the Grixis Twin decks or one of the Obzon decks, there's actually a lot of counterplay going on. So we're going to see a lot of matches that aren't over very quickly here once you get the more controlling decks matched up against the aggro decks. But there aren't very many super unfair, like, really quick combo kill decks either. There's no Amulet Bloom. There's no Gristle Shoal. There's not even a Tron deck. And those are the decks that tend to end the games around turn three or so, which we're not seeing a ton of. Even Living End, as uninteractive as it is, it still ends the game turn six. And the green-white deck can't really kill you before turn five or six all that often.
Yeah, I admire Affinity because it is quite interactive in how it plays. It's an aggro combo style deck, sure, but in a specific game, it's kind of up to the player where they want to collapse all of their cards onto. If that's like an Arcbound Ravager, if it is the Ink Moth Nexus, as we saw Sam defeat his opponent in game one with. So those minute choices in gameplay make it quite an interesting aggro deck to play.
Yeah, I'm glad that's the case, because it looks like we're going to be seeing a fair bit of it today. Got a couple more. Got another round after this to cover, but
yeah, I know Owen also chose to play Affinity. It makes a lot of sense to play the decks with which you're comfortable, but also a deck like Affinity has a lot of choices. So if you're a good player, you're able to leverage those very well.
That's a bit less of a concern at this tournament compared to, say, a Pro Tour or a Grand Prix, especially because this field is full of incredibly good players. So I definitely agree that goes into deck selection. But when you're talking about a field where almost everyone you play against is just going to be great, then I think you more look at getting the metagame choices right than you do unnecessarily biasing towards interaction, even though that's a very good way to think about deck selection in general.
Right, which is also why it's so strange that so many people are playing Hexproof.
All right, looks like we're underway here in game two. Sam Black won in game one. And let's see if he has a good start like he did that time. He's got an Ink Moth Nexus to kick things off. He's just going to pass the turn. I did see that he's got a he's got an Ornithopter in his hand. Why would he keep that in his hand, Jackie?
So the main reason to keep Ornithopter in hand there is there's no reason to expose it to removal if your opponent not going to do anything with it. If you're not going to attack or use it for Springleaf Drum, you might as well just wait on it.
Yeah, I'm struggling to see Sam's hand here. All right, so
it looks like they're still populating it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't see.
Now that Tiago's tapped out for a Tarmogoyf, Sam is a little happier in playing Steel Overseer. If Tiago had just passed with two lands up, then you would just, you know, sense an abrupt decay and be a little less happy about this turn of events. But we'll see if that Steel Overseer actually gets to use its ability. They tend not to. That card is built as a lightning rod for removals.
Yeah. It's also very easy to kill.
Affinity is also so explosive that...
Speaking of...
Right. So Sam could do all of this on this turn when he played the Overseer. And so that way, Tiago didn't have information about how many Ornithopters Sam had until this turn. So it could have been, oh, all of his cards are expensive. He doesn't have any good plays. So that could potentially have made his opponent play a little differently.
This is really interesting here, too, because, you know, Sam Black, up until this point, did not have access to colored mana, specifically blue. And he does have a Thoughtcast in his hand. So even though his Steel Overseer ate a Path to Exile, he does get to search up that island this time, and it could unlock future spells in his hand now.
Sam chose to side in Thoughtseize. It's funny because Thoughtseize is not traditionally the kind of card you want in this matchup, but post-board games, Sam has to assume that there are some cards that he cares about, especially if Tiago's going to be siding them in. So Thoughtseize makes a lot more sense.
He's got one in his hand here. hand. Let's see what his next plate looks like. Arcbound Ravager?
Yeah, because that'll make the thought cast cost the minimum amount of mana.
He counts it up for Tiago's benefit as well. All right. Finds a Glimmer Void and a Memnite.
Right, Glimmer Void does let him cast the Thoughtseize, so this is...
No, you passed me. I had these on turn two, and then you passed me.
Debate over how to him get to four mana. Of course, Path to Exile did actually find a land this time.
Well, I didn't draw an island.
And there's that Thoughtseize. So Glimmer Void's going to reveal, looks like Path, Lingering Souls, and Siege Rhino.
Tiago doesn't have a fourth land or a black land yet. Still... You're not going to take Lingering Souls, so that clearly, you know, narrows it down to Siege Rhino or Path. Siege Rhino is not actually the biggest threat against Affinity, because Affinity tends to just go over the top with much bigger cards. I could see just taking Path and hoping that your Ravager is enough to take things home.
See, I'm going to write down the hand diligently before making his decision. This looks like it's not an easy decision for Sam here either. He is taking his time with this one.
Jackie, what would you take here if you were Sam?
It's pretty difficult. I think that knowing that Sam has an Arcbound Ravager, I'd probably take the Path to Exile.
Yeah, that's what I was leaning towards. Sam actually chose to take Lingering Souls, mm-hmm. which is funny given that it has flashback, but again, Tiago doesn't have any black mana. So Sam is taking what I think is an aggressive line here because he's really just trying to finish this game before Tiago draws black mana, because once Tiago does, Tiago's got a lot of cards he can cast.
That does make a lot of sense. And that kind of is the point of Thoughtseize in an aggressive deck like Affinity too. Just kind of keep the opponent off of things that could thwart you, especially since you're so weak against anti-artifact sideboard cards.
So is this Ravager enough, given the board state we have now, to actually get, you know, enough damage in for Sam to win, or is he going to need help?
Well, his plan, I believe, was to use Ink Moth Nexus and just poison Tiago out quickly, but Tiago did draw the black mana, did play flashback Lingering Souls. Sam would still have to deal with that Path to Exile, though.
Yeah, in theory, he could just pile all of his artifacts onto the Ink Moth Nexus and deal 10 poison worth of damage over two turns. But because Tiago still has the Path to Exile, that's not going to really be an option.
And I think Sam's plan, he has a second Thoughtseize in hand, so I think his plan was to take Lingering Souls, then take Path, and then try to finish the game with Nexus. The black mana that Tiago drew made that
dagger.
A lot tougher.
Yeah,
tougher.
And it also let him make a play with the black mana and still have the white mana available for the Path, so he could use it now. Pretty rough spot there for Sam. He left the door open just a little bit, and Tiago kind of kicked it down. Got some updates from our back tables as well. Martin Mila is tied up with Paulo Vitor Dama de Rosa on the King of the Hill match, and Paul Rietzel wins two quick games over Andre Strosky.
So Tiago is going to fire off this Path on the Ravager, and Sam taking Lingering Souls makes a lot more sense if he has the second Thoughtseize, and that explains why he did not take the Path the first time, which, you know, us not having the complete information, we're leaning towards taking Path, but Sam was crafting a game plan here, which is something you should always be doing. He's looking to how he was going to win this game over the next couple turns.
Yeah, that makes far more sense, knowing there's another Thoughtseize.
So Sam deciding now, how big does he want this Ravager to be? And the answer is not much bigger.
Of course, it's the Siege Rhino. It's going to get Thoughtseized away here. So Sam taking a fairly conservative route there, knowing that Tiago is going to be empty-handed after this, he just moved the counter over to an Ornithopter.
It is tough, though, because Tarmogoyf and Scavenging Goose are an actual clock, so Sam doesn't have all the time in the world here.
Yeah, Vault Scourge isn't going to do it on its own here either. Interesting turn there. So he played the vault skirt post thoughtseize here. Because, you know, one way he can combat is to get some counters on the Scourge.
And he didn't pay the iron price either. He actually spent black mana on it, so he didn't want to take extra damage.
Yeah, at this point, Thiago just has more power on the board than Sam, so...
Yeah, he's rumbling, too.
Yeah, Tarmogoyf is one of the better ways for Obzon to close out the game, because it's just a 2-mana 4-5 or 5-6 some of the time. And while you're disrupting Affinity's main game plan, you could just get to keep attacking with it. One of the main advantages Obzon has over Jund, because the decks are quite similar, is that in this matchup, Lingering Souls is just one of your best cards. It just stops so many of Sam's avenues to win here. So even if Sam draws something like a Cranial Plating, Lingering Souls will buy Thiago a lot of time.
Yeah. He only gets half of it, but half of Lingering Souls turns out pretty good here, too.
Yeah, Sam does not look happy about his position.
No. His hand is Signal Pest, Mox Opal. He's going to play the Pest. He's just going to pass the turn back. So, yeah, Sam in a tough spot here as Thiago just kind of happily chipping away with his big creatures on the ground.
And Thiago has to balance the size of his scavenging ooze and the size of his Tarmogoyf. You notice there's an Ornithopter hanging out in Sam's graveyard, but presumably if the scavenging ooze eats that, then the Tarmogoyf shrinks by the corresponding amount. So you want to manage both your numbers there. And it is the sort of thing where if there's a turn where maybe the ooze is unblocked, Thiago could choose to put extra power there, but for the most part, I think he's fine keeping just the minimum one creature in the graveyard.
Yeah, I think if he exiled that Ornithopter, would actually reduce it by two. Well, not anymore. Signal Pest joins the team. And there's that Lingering Souls.
Second Lingering Souls, that is brutal.
Yeah. Also, we'll see that, you know, another possible late game plan that Tiago's brought to the table there is Gavinny Township. He doesn't have enough mana to activate it yet, but that is a sort of after the dust settles style game plan that we've seen from this Obzon deck, and that will do it. Sam Black has given up. And Thiago Saporito is going to even things up and make this one game apiece. So we're going to get a game three on our main match here.
It is shocking that the plan of thought-seizing Lingering Souls did not pan out.
Yeah.
Okay, so why don't we take a look at what looks like a game three here between Paulo Vitor Dama de Rosa and Martin Mila over on our King of the Hill match. You see them on the left there. Paulo, on the left-hand side, is playing Grixis Twin. And yeah, it looks like Living End just resolved there. Not the most savage Living End we've seen, but Architects of Will and a Monstrous Carabid.
And you notice Paulo prioritized fetching basics here to play around Fulminator Mage. So Paulo's got a grip of options. I mean, this is why Paulo plays a deck like this. He just loves sitting there, seven cards in his hand, have a million cards to cast, some of which are Cryptic Command, and has to decide how to win this game even though he's behind.
Yeah, it's funny. I get to watch him down in the feature match here. He just seems so in his element, Jackie. Every turn was, think about it, draw his card, say go, and then start thinking.
That's great.
He could just do everything on his opponent's turn anyway.
Yeah, and of course his deck is twin, so one of those options is just win the game sometimes.
Whoops. Yeah, he did that too.
Dismember taking out Tasker as yet another one of the spells that don't get cascaded into but can be cast for small amounts of mana.
Get Sam Black shuffling in stereo here. You can see that on the upper right-hand corner. That's our main match here.
It sounds really randomized.
You know, I actually love the sound of shuffling. I like that we have that sound pipe right into our ears here.
Yeah, I love shuffling.
It's soothing.
I just like the tactile elements of Magic.
There's no better sound than shuffling your opponent's deck when they're mulliganing to five. I would want just great games all the time.
Yeah, Eric Froelich walks by and gives us a big thumbs up there. He agrees. All right. Keep the cycle train rolling here with a dead shot Minotaur, though. It looks like Paulo said, hold on a sec. I might want to do something. Yeah, go for it. Knock yourself out.
So
this clock is very real, though.
Paulo could take this hit down to two. Presumably he's going to play like a Cryptic or a Deceiver Exarch, something along those lines.
And get it ricochet trapped or something. All right, well, this one shores up the board state quite nicely.
Yeah, Cryptic tapping your team and drawing a card can't actually get ricochet trapped, which is nice because it doesn't actually target anything.
Yeah.
Is it time to hardcast a Monstrous Carabid? Probably not. But it usually isn't, but...
I mean, how many Carabids is enough?
Right now, one is not. Yeah, he's just going to cycle it. And he finds...
It looks like maybe Demonic Dread.
But he just passes a turn back here.
And this is where... This is what kind of the position that Living Under would prefer to be in. We saw an earlier match where it was like this, except Living Under had no creatures in play. Keeping mana up to stop a Splinter Twin is all well and good when you're pressuring your opponent, which Martin is right now, but he does not like to do that when he doesn't have anything in play. So this the Monstrous Carabid actually is breathing down Paulo's neck here.
All right, why don't we jump back up to our main feature match here, Thiago Saporito versus Sam Black, as we don't want to blink. That one went by pretty quickly both times. And I want to make sure that we get at the action. And yeah, this is why. That's turn one there for Sam Black. Darksteel, Citadel, Ornithopter, Springleaf Drum, Vault Scourge, all on turn one.
Yeah, that is a great start. But as always, you have to see what the follow-up is. If the follow-up is play a Signal Pest and another Ornithopter, that's very different than play a Cranial Plating or play an Etch Champion.
About as quick of a start as Tiago's deck can muster here is this, turn one Noble Hierarch. That does unlock a lot of early plays for his deck to help keep him in the race. But see what Sam Black comes up with here. Well, it's Thoughtcast, Luis, so it's neither of those big hitters, but maybe he'll draw one?
Yeah, it's not one of the high-impact cards, but it's also a pretty good card to play because Sam has the time and mana to really develop his board here.
He's got two mana available. He's going to attack for one with the Vault Scourge. And does he have something to affect the board here?
Well, he has a Cranial Plating. So the question is, does he actually want to run it out? Or at least it looked like he did.
So Sam's got two Vault Scourges. The Cranial Plating is looking pretty good. But unfortunately, because Thiago played turn one Noble Hierarch, he actually has turn two Lingering Souls if he wants.
Wow, that's huge. Now, Sam.
Apparently, Sam actually has Gyarapur Aethergrid in hand, is what it looks like.
What?
Yeah, he has two from his sideboard.
Which is a pretty spicy sideboard option. That, for those of you who haven't played much Origins Limited, that this is.
Even for those that have.
Yeah, it's true. This basically means that Sam can shoot things for 2 to 3 damage a turn, if not more.
Yeah, so right now he can do it for 3. Okay, you can get 2 in this turn.
And this just immediately guns down the Noble and can start gunning down the Lingering Souls.
What the heck?
Sam's going to run away with this game very, very quickly.
Yeah.
That's very powerful.
The turn back.
Thiago has his own answer in Pithing Needle here, though, which he can actually name the Aether Grid to take it out.
Is the damage done at this point? Sure, he can play a Pithy Needle, which means that he at least has a chance to go into the future. But how far setback did he just get there, even just from that one turn?
It was a pretty big setback. Sam, unfortunately, has the second copy in his hand, and which the needle will stop both.
I think Tiago's asking if he can name the Aether Grid. Is that what he's doing?
I would assume so. The answer would be yes. And
it's an activated ability.
It is.
Right.
And then it really comes down to whether Tiago can stop two Vault Scourges, which, given he's got a Lingering Souls in his graveyard, the answer is probably yes.
Probably, yeah.
I drafted a lot of Gyarapur Aethergrid when I was playing in R&D before Origins came out. Yeah.
Was it good at one point?
Are you
I
the
think
one
it's
that
good. I mean, it looks pretty good right now, and this is modern, so.
Yeah. All I know is I have tried to draft that card, and it has really not panned out. So.
Yeah, it's tough.
Build around me uncommons for two and a red are kind of Luis's wheelhouse. If he can't make it work.
Sorceries that cost two and a red are my wheel of fortune.
Here's
yeah, maybe that's
Pithy
true.
Pithy Needle. So Pithy Needle does, in fact, name the Aether Grid. And Luis, did you say that Sam has another copy of it in his hand, too? Of the Aether Grid?
That's what it looked like, according to our hand cam here.
Yeah, that's unfortunate.
Well, it depends. If you want Thiago to win, then it's not. So I'm sure at least one of those players are satisfied with this outcome.
Yeah. I meant for Sam. Thiago's going to get aggro here. He's still got the flashback on that Lingering Souls lying in wait.
And here, even though Noble and one of the tokens got killed by the first grid, this flashback, I mean, Thiago's got three Lingering Souls tokens in play, which trades for both Fault Scourges and one of the Nexus, depending on what Sam does.
Jeez.
Though Blink Moth Nexus actually does help in these grindy games because it can make Ink Moth Nexus bigger.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that is surprisingly relevant a lot of the time.
Yeah, without that, Sam would have no game going whatsoever here, just trading off for Lingering Souls tokens. Thiago looks like he's not going to block.
Yeah, you can usually take the first couple poison hits pretty casually.
Is there no blocks?
And especially without a plating a Ravager lurking around. So I wouldn't be surprised if Thiago wants to set up using like a path or something along those lines rather than trading off multiple tokens.
Looks like Thiago has an Abrupt Decay in hand, which is very good in this position. Since he was able to Pithing Needle the Aether Grid, the Abrupt Decay can deal with almost anything that Sam could potentially recoup his loss in tempo in this game with.
Here's another Lingering Souls for Thiago Saporito. A nice draw for Thiago here against Sam, and that Pithy Needle was perfect. It's effectively taking out two things, and especially one that was going to threaten to just dominate the game for Sam Black. Now, you don't normally think of Affinity of having ways to deal with opposing permanents like Pithy Needle. There's just nothing, right?
No, I wouldn't expect Sam to have a solution.
Yeah. That Pithy Needle doing overtime work for Thiago here, looking to move to 4-2 down the stretch here in day one of the World Championship. Sam Black trying to avoid 3-3 going into the last round.
And Jackie, like you said, Sam drew a Seal Overseer, and Thiago now has the Abrupt Decay to kill it before it does any damage.
Yeah.
Right.
Thiago's getting aggressive here, too. He attacked with three spirits last turn just to get in for a damage.
So if Thiago doesn't have a plan for this Nexus, this attack is not going to work out all that profitably for him. He's trading a spirit token for two damage here, which isn't a trade he can keep making.
It's pretty aggressive. Another quick match update here. Martin Milla does defeat Paulo Vitor Dama de Rosa 2-1. Looks like Antonio Del Moral Leon and Kentaro Yamamoto are tied at a game apiece as well.
I wonder if Thiago has a plan to cast like a damnation or something. He just wanted to get that Nexus activated.
Doesn't look like it. He's going to use the Abrupt Decay here. And flashback Lingering Soul. So he's just on the grind.
It's pretty typical of the Yobs on deck. As you can see from his Stirring Wildwind play, one of the advantages of that deck is everything's a threat, even your lands.
And there's that miserable second copy of Gyarpur Aether Grid just rotting away in Sam Black's hand. He draws a Glimmer Void for the turn. Not going to change his fortunes here. What is he looking to draw? Like, he's got Thiago to 14. It's not like he's in burn range. Can Sam get out of this at this point?
Well, Sam certainly isn't done here. Like, a Cranial Plating would be great for Sam. He can just keep moving it around and keep running your Ornithopters in, trading for two spirits. Even Ravager or Etch Champion would do something. The thing is, Thiago actually isn't getting a ton of damage through. Ornithopters do a good job of stopping spirit tokens, and the Nexus the Blink Moth interaction with Ink Moth Nexus or with itself mean that Thiago can't really attack into the spirits. After that one turn, Thiago realized that wasn't a great plan.
Yeah. Yeah, that wasn't a good long-term plan for Thiago. So he's lifted off the gas pedal there and just starts attacking with Stirring Wildwood. That's a 3-4 here. Sam says, sure, take it. Drop to 10. Go.
Thiago tried to pay 4 mana to activate it, but Sam didn't let him get away with that.
I think that was a Ravager. Okay. So that was one of the cards on your list, right, Luis?
It was. Ravager is not as great as Cranial Plating here. Still definitely a threat. Getting through all those spirit tokens is going to be very annoying for Sam, though.
Oh, you mean the 6 spirit tokens floating around on Tiago's side? Goodness sakes.
Yeah, this certainly changes the board state, but if I were Sam, I would have been hoping for an Etched Champion, perhaps a Cranial Plating. Cranial Plating and Arcbound Ravager do almost the same thing, but Arcbound Ravager is more weak against removal, which Thiago does have quite a bit of in his deck.
Thiago hoping that he's got a Panglacial Worm hanging out in his library here.
Couldn't find it.
And again, both players at 3-2, which, you know, not the record you're hoping to start with, but at the World Championships is not a bad record at all. This is a tournament with a lot of rounds and not a lot of players, so the record you need to advance is frequently not as good as you would expect. Like, you know, it's not like trying to make top 8 in a 400-person field. So 3-2 is a good record, and the winner of this match is going to be very well set up going into the last round.
It looks like that is a Scavenging Ooze.
Yeah, he's got a Scavenging Ooze on his side now as well, so perhaps another attacker. Whoa, here we go, Sam Black.
And here's the champion.
And that's what Sam was looking for, because the combination of Ravager and champion means that since Thiago isn't able to kill the Ravager in response, Sam can, at some point, just pile up a bunch of counters on Ravager, move him over to the champion, and end up putting Thiago on like a 2-turn clock of protection from everything. Almost a 1-turn clock. It's actually not that far away from doing 13 in one hit.
Wow.
Though I don't think he quite gets there.
Well, this was a nice turn of events for Sam Black here. Ravager into champion. Thiago looked like he was in a very good spot just 2 turns ago, and now all of a sudden it looks like Sam Black has some real threats going.
It is a little bit tricky, because if Sam wants to sacrifice all of his artifacts onto the Etched Champion, he has to think about the amount of life that Thiago can potentially gain. He does have that Scavenging Ooze on the board. So if Sam sacrifices artifact creatures, then the ooze can potentially just eat them and lengthen the clock that Sam wants to advance.
Yeah, what I'm curious about here is what is Sam's line of act? Like, is he going to look to actively press here and try to close this game out in a quick fashion? Or is he willing to let it sort of draw out for 2 or 3 turns to mitigate that risk a little bit?
Sam's definitely going to try to close this out. I wouldn't expect him to go completely and sack everything, especially since you need to keep Metalcraft. But there's no reason to let Thiago get 5 more, 6 more draw steps when you can put him on like a 2 or 3 turn clock. Probably closer to 3 because of the Scavenging Ooze.
Sam finally got to discard that gear per Aether grade. Well, good riddance.
It's actually worse discarded than in play because of potential Tarmogoyfs.
That's
but
true.
those don't appear to be on the horizon. Yeah, imagine if Gear Per Aether Grid wasn't named by Needle here. It would have just ended the game many turns ago.
Certainly. This is a very complex board at this point.
Thiago's jamming with all of his spirit tokens.
And Thiago could have one of his few answers to Etched Champion in Damnation. He was able to sideboard in a Damnation, and it could be that he's hoping to just cast Damnation and at least have the board be relatively clear. Otherwise, this attack, I mean, it does some damage. It gets 3 points of damage through.
Yeah, one of them got eaten up by a pumped up Nexus there.
I think thing is, Sam at some point can also just start trading vault scrolls for tokens, gaining a life in the process, which makes it much harder for Thiago to finish things off. Looked like a galvanic blast to me, but we'll find out in a second. If it is, that
was
that,
was it a vault scourge that he drew?
We will see.
All right, we'll wait on that.
So Sam now deciding, this is the tough part. This is the Ravager math. How many artifacts do you sacrifice to Ravager? What kind of clock do you want to present?
And like Jackie mentioned earlier, the scavenger knew is sitting there threatening to gain a bunch of life as well.
And it was a galvanic blast, so... Blast could also potentially kill scavengers if there's enough, depending on how many creatures are in graveyards, in which case Sam could then start to try to set off the reaction of sacking a bunch of creatures, but...
Yeah, it looks like that's going to depend on creatures in graveyard more than green mana available.
Yeah, so Thiago has four. Looks like there's only one creature in the graveyard, so Sam could successfully Galvanic Blast the Scavenging Ooze, though if Thiago has removal in response, that is kind of problematic.
Sam rummages around in his opponent's graveyard a little, trying to get an idea for what kind of food is available.
Thiago's very much missing Gavinny Township at this point.
Yeah.
If he had drawn a Gavinny Township, this game would have been presumably concluded a few turns ago, just because the spirit tokens would have been 3/3s or 4/4s in short order.
Yeah, Sam's deliberating really hard. This is probably the critical turn of game three. It's going to determine the match.
You can tell that Sam Black is taking some extra time to make sure he gets this turn right for that reason.
Do you think it's worth thinking really hard at the World Championships and on the really critical turn or no?
Great question, Louise. Yes. All right, stage one. Attack with Edge Champion. In it goes. Protection from all colors. He says, yeah.
Yeah, what can I do?
Even the Stirring Wildwood becomes a colored creature. So
one of the big concerns here is that Sam could not use Galvanic Blast if he chose to, and then try to Galvanic Blast Thiago to shorten the clock even more and just avoid sacrificing creatures. We'll see which direction he heads, because if he's going to blast the ooze, he's clearly going to do it before sacrificing any creatures. It could be that he wants to avoid sacrificing creatures entirely, and this lets him keep Galvanic Blast up to either point at Thiago or try to finish him off in some other way.
So it looks like he has sacrificed pretty much everything except his Air Force, which is defending his board against all of those spirits.
Yeah, he sacrificed a couple of Darksteel Citadels and ultimately the Ravager, which is going to put Thiago down to 7, and I think, you know, Sam probably has it sorted out here so that he can hit Thiago next turn.
And then blast to finish him off.
And then blast to finish him off, even though Thiago probably thinks that, you know, maybe he can get out of it with the ooze or something along those lines. What did Thiago draw for the turn? Is that a swamp? Oh, look at that slow squeeze from Thiago.
It needs to be a damnation for him to survive here, because as long as Sam can avoid putting any creatures in the graveyard, then... Or he could actually even one can hit the graveyard, but Sam has to avoid putting two creatures in the graveyard in order for Thiago to not be able to survive via Scavenging Ooze.
And is Gavinny Township too late here?
Gavinny Township would not quite do it, though.
Just chump blocks.
It looks like he may have drawn Siege Rhino, which is another card which could extend his game for one turn.
Wow, Siege Rhino is actually almost exactly enough. It's slightly over it that could do it, because Thiago is very close to presenting lethal here, and if Sam's forced to start trading off creatures, then the ooze all of a sudden might buy Thiago an extra additional turn. So Citrono is a pretty big draw here. It's also a big creature. It's also a very good card.
I can see why he may be playing it.
Let's see if he what kind of line he puts together here. He says, well, let's go to attacks. Start off by rumbling with... Looks like he's going for the team here. Maybe leaf back a spirit? Nah. I think he's sort of seen how this looks to him.
Not leaving any spirits back could open the door for those vault scourges to start attacking, which is rough.
I think that this could potentially determine the game if it weren't for Sam's Galvanic Blast. I think that in addition to his board, that could potentially put his life total over the top.
Well, Sam might block to put himself dead to Siege Rhino here. Looks like he's going to avoid that, but...
Yeah, he could have easily taken too much damage this turn. It looks like he's just going to pump up that Ink Moth. And he...
So Sam falls to six takes, after the life gain off the Scourge.
Takes two, gains one, yep, and he loses a life going to six. Still clearly out of range of Siege Rhino. Who makes an appearance here on the battlefield. So Sam Black down to three, Saporito up to 12.
And effective 13 because of that scavenging ooze. Sam, very close to killing Thiago here because he can attack with Blink Moth Nexus, Vault Scourge, and Etch Champion for eight, and then Galvanic Blast Thiago down to zero, except for the scavenging ooze.
So Thiago can't activate it in that scenario, right? He has to just let it sit.
Well, he could have activated before attacks happen. He can't fall to four and then activate it.
Right.
The question is, what happens if Sam doesn't... Like, if Sam just attacks with Etch Champion, he can hit Thiago down to presumably lethal in one turn, but then he has to chump the Scavenging Ooze, block Siege Rhino. Sam actually has trouble here. He not Galvanic Blasting the Scavenging Ooze in order to present a faster clock may have ended up backfiring because of the Siege Rhino draw. It seemed like a very logical line, but Siege Rhino is the perfect card for Thiago to draw besides something like Damnation.
Kentaro Yamamoto has defeated Antonio de Moral Leon 2-1 in one of our side tables. Looks like the Tarmogoyf of Kentaro Yamamoto just kind of beat up on Antonio, who didn't have him.
Yeah,
similar deck, Tarmo Twin. Yeah, go ahead, Jackie.
Yeah, they're both playing Twin, but I guess the Tarmo Twin beats the normal Twin in this instance.
Yeah.
So Sam, in kind of an unfortunate position of having to leave back Etch Champion. The good thing is that also makes Tiago's attacks not spectacular because Thiago has to contend with a 6-6 protection from everything defender. So, and the Spirit Tokens, as we've seen, just keep running into that Ink Moth Nexus.
So this is another big draw, then, if Thiago can find something. Another Siege Rhino?
Is that something named Siege Rhino? Because that's what we're looking for here.
That would be the game. Yeah, the other Siege Rhino being on the battlefield's rough for Sam Black, too, just the big trampler. And it looks like he says, okay, if you eat my Siege Rhino with this...
Do you want to trade Siege Rhino for Ornithopter? At that point, you also get to attack with tokens. A token gets blocked by Ornithopter. A token gets blocked by Nexus.
And one gets through. Which would mean Siege Rhino would be lethal.
Well, Sam also has the option of just activating two of the Nexi, but then, of course, they die. Actually, Sam can activate two and then use Blink Moth. So Sam could block two and lose one of the Nexus to a token, but the other one will survive because of Blink Moth. But presumably, if Thiago has Siege Rhino, he's in decent shape here. You know, Sterling Wildwood changed the equation as well.
Yeah. And he's attacking with everything here. So he's got three big threats, a 3-4, a 4-5. And a 6-6, and then he's got the four little spirits also hitting the red zone here. It is a lot of heat.
So because Siege Rhino has trample and because the ooze is potentially pretty large, it makes sense to start with these blocks and then decide what you want to do about the ooze. Sam's Galvanic Blast surprisingly not that relevant here because it can't kill any of Thiago's biggest attackers. It can kill the Stirring Wildwood,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
But that prevents Sam from activating two of the Nexuses.
I think it is Nexuses, by the way.
Nexuses?
Yeah.
Is? Or no?
No.
So Sam debating chumping One reason to conserve Galvanic Blast instead of casting on the Wildwood here is that Sam really wants to try to finish Thiago off. Sam, rather than being in a commanding position, is actually now in how do I steal the game mode, which is always a tough, you know, switch.
But it is a mode that Affinity is pretty equipped to do. He's got a lot of cranial platings and just explosive cards that he can draw and thought cast to make sure that he draws them.
Definitely. The problem is if Sam ends up being forced to trade off a lot of his creatures, cranial plating stops being all that appealing. So. Galvanic Blast eats the Stirring Wildwood. Sam has concluded that he can't afford to try to shoot Thiago with Galvanic Blast, and now he's in just kind of damage prevention mode.
Yeah, this is a lot worse for him. He's actually going to fall down to two here. That includes a chump block with that Ornithopter there. And Thiago just pulls ever further ahead here.
Well, Thiago does presumably need to draw something at some point because Sam has a pretty good defensive squad still. Springleaf Drum's not going to help it all that much. But so you leave back the champion to block Scavenging Ooze. Ornithopter blocks token. Nexus blocks token. The Vault Scourge kind of trades off for a token. At this point, Sam's pecking in for one, and Thiago doesn't have a good attack. So that's not that bad for Sam. It just means that if Thiago does draw something, then Sam will all of a sudden be in trouble.
Looks like he's considering going on the aggression with his Ink Moth Nexuses.
Yeah, I think he's just looking at that as a possible option here, but
It could also be that Sam decides he wants to chump with his lands and then in order to attack with the Etch Champion. You know, Sam also has to worry about not having Metalcraft. If he goes too low, if the Ornithopter and the Vault Scourge die, all of a sudden the champion is looking a little lonely.
Right, you just going to really get in there with a Scourge.
Can't really be a champion if you don't have someone to be a champion for.
Exactly.
Etched or otherwise. So Tiago's going to eat up a creature there out of the graveyard again with his Scavenging Ooze, get another counter on it. And what was it?
Engineered Explosives. So he's
going
to cast it for three in order to kill the champion here.
Wow, that dodges
his stuff very
nicely.
That's one of the few ways to interact with it.
Jeez.
It also killed the Gyarapir Aethergrid, which I'm sure is high on Tiago's list of priorities.
You see that they just put it under the pithy needle.
See, he pointed to the other good.
Yeah,
first.
Well,
that was the real killer.
Yeah. All right. Well, the scourge of that pithy needle Aether Grid finally out of the way, and Thiago Saporito has the way clear here. Just the lands and an Ornithopter back to block, which looks like it means that just the Scavenging Ooze is going to attack though.
Yeah, the attack with the tokens is just not that impressive here. So I like the attacking with just the ooze, forcing Sam to throw away a card of some kind.
Yeah, Thiago does have two poison counters, so I think it does make sense to defend against that.
Yeah, especially since now Thiago is once again in a commanding position, so he's fine just taking the slightly more conservative route.
So Sam's going to chump block with the Nexus. It is going to chew up a couple of the counters from the ooze, but it's still big enough to kill Sam on its own. Another Nexus off the top here for Sam Black. He just can't find a way to mount an offensive here, and as he slowly but surely falls further and further behind on the board, things start to become less and less likely for him to win. You can see that his board state has gone from wide to narrow over the course of the last two or three turns.
And now Tiago's in the spot where if he draws something, he probably just straight up wins, and he's already winning without drawing anything. That's a good spot to be in.
I like that spot.
That Siege Rhino was so clutch
this
game.
That was huge.
Yeah, is that the only time Siege Rhino has been a really great top deck, or has it happened in other matches?
Not when I've been in the booth, but
do you think we're going to see any Siege Rhinos tomorrow? given the standard portion
standard
of the tournament is tomorrow and also on Sunday, yes, I imagine we'll see some Siege Rhinos.
Did you just answer your own question?
Well, it was a really difficult question to answer, so I was the only one qualified to do so.
I see.
That or it was incredibly obvious.
And passes the turn back. Is that the Dromica's command? Does he have those at his board?
He does have one, yes.
I think he just drew it.
He does. It's a way to kill Girp or Aethergrid.
It is. Does he have an avenue to victory this turn with the Dromica's command in mind? Doesn't look like it.
Again, just like Tiaga drew it up, Dromica's command to kill an Ornithopter.
With nothing on it.
And then followed by an abrupt decay to kill a Vault Scourge.
Jeez. And that's it. Thiago Saporito defeats Sam Black 2-1 to improve his record to 4-2. And like you said, Luis, you know, if people are used to watching coverage at home of the Pro Tour or a Grand Prix, you need a pretty exceptional record to make the top eight at those bigger field tournaments, especially the GPs. But even a Pro Tour with something, you know, in the 300 to 400 person range, you still need X4, X3, somewhere in that range to do it. But here, that's not the case.
No. Again, given 14 rounds and 24 players, making top four usually takes a worse record.
Right. Welcome back to the booth. Marshall Sutcliffe, Jackie Lee, and Luis Scott Vargas. And that was a fun one. We're winding down Modern here on day one. This is the constructed portion. Of course, we played Modern Masters 2015 draft earlier today, and now Modern Constructed is sort of winding it down. We've got one more round to go before we wrap things up here from Seattle. But it's been good, right? I mean, I think the Modern rounds are pretty exciting. Like you said, the decks did end up getting kind of grouped together, but overall, still pretty diverse, as we'd expect from Modern.
Yeah, I love to see the very diverse matchups. They have such wildly different gameplay styles, and that's something that I really enjoy about Modern.
Yeah, and, you know, from the commentator booth perspective, it's great for us too, right? Because, yeah, you know, when you get the fourth iteration of the same type of matchup, you're like, okay, I've definitely seen this before. I've been down this road. But with Modern, it tends to happen less often for us, so it's pretty nice too. All right, well, why don't we send it over to the news desk and Richard Hagen.
I can't think of a good answer. Oh, I'm glad you did. Welcome back to the news desk. Rich Hagen here, bringing you all the action four from the floor. Let's take a look at four more of the matches that have just been taking place here at the World Championship. Going to head you on down. And we're going to start with that man, Sean McLaren, who has been the leader against Seth Manfield. And Manfield is really delivering here on the biggest stage of all. There you see Manfield in action. It is Manfield who won that one to advance to 5-1 and be co-leader of this tournament. McLaren was 4-0, now 4-2, and that puts him right back in the pack. There you see Owen Turtenwald and Mike Sigrist going at it in their match. There is Owen Turtenwald. A lot of people think he's going to do very well, and there's your player of the year, Mike Sigrist. Turtenwald won that one. Turtenwell to 4-2. Sigrist back in the pack, halfway 50-50, 3-3. So Ari Lax looking on there. He has not had a great day. He's at 1-5. But this man, Martin Dang, still going. A European teammate clash. Dang against Joel Larsen. They've had a lot of clashes between the team, four of them. Lots of fun, but obviously not great to play a teammate. Larsen wins that one, 4-2 to him. And Dang is at 3-3. And then finally, there you see Yuya Watanabe. And you see plenty of artifacts on board there on the other side of the table for Jacob Wilson. Wilson could not get it done. Wilson at 3-3. Yuya Watanabe, 5-1. All right, well, we have another deck tech lined up for you. Let's head across town and find out the very special guest waiting with Brian David Marshall.